Hello and welcome to RecomBEERS, the weekly show where the good folks here at Recombu get together, have a bit of a drink and a bit of a natter about all the big stories in the world of tech and entertainment. And this week I am joined by the wonderful and bearded staff writer for Recombu, Mr. Peter Phelps. Peter, welcome.
Hi guys, nice to join you. I'm not sure if I'm going to live up to that billing, but I hope so.
I mean, the beard is for sure.
Well, thank you.
Listen, as someone who just like can grow only the patchiest of facial hair, I'm truly in awe. So yeah, you've got the lockdown beard down to like a perfect 10.
Well, I think it's good that you're here to give, you know, the smooth-faced cherubim some representation as well, because otherwise it's in danger of heading towards Recon Beards with me, Alan, Max. So there we go.
Actually, yeah, I think that's a good point. Yeah, you've all got beards. It's literally just me. And you know, just to point out, I haven't shaved in a couple of days and it looks like nothing's happened. I know, it's... Yeah, damn it, I am turning it into RecomBEERS now. But Pia, as is per the title of the show, RecomBEERS, I've got to know, what are you drinking for this week's episode?
Okay, so today I'm having Club Tropica from Tiny Rebel, not to be confused with Tropicana by Wham, but it's a nice tropical tasting IPA.
What if you were just drinking Tropicana?
Yeah, that would be a good disguise. How about you? Last I heard, you are alcohol free, so you really might be drinking Tropicana.
I might as well be. I'm back on the old Heineken 0%, although last time I think I was on, I had the can and I've upgraded to the bottle, you know, to see if it makes a difference. Now, I'll admit I've had one of these already. I had one yesterday. It does actually taste better from the bottle. So if you're looking for a decent non-alcoholic, Heineken 0 from the bottle, gets a recommendation from me. Please sponsor us.
Yeah, I always think they taste better from the bottle, but when I've actually looked this up, apparently it's better preserved in a can. So, everything, I've just got bad taste.
It's I'm inclined to agree with you on that. I mean, sure, maybe there's some science behind it with a can, but just I'd rather have the bottle. It looks the part, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But anyway, as much as I would love to talk about, you know, beer until the cows come home, maybe we should do that for one episode. Let's start out with the real meat and potatoes of the program, winners and losers. So, Pia, the big winner of the week, and I think you can agree on this as much because you wrote the big what is on the platform piece for Recombu. It is, of course, the launch of Star on Disney Plus. Now, this has... I can't even remember now when Star was announced. I want to say it was late last year, but you know, we've known that Disney might have some sort of plan to incorporate, I guess, the content that it had in Hulu in the US, but bring it over to the UK and the rest of the world. And it's done exactly that with Star, which is just to me, it's exactly what Disney Plus needs to combat Netflix properly. But do you feel the same way?
Yeah, well, I think it's definitely needs that extra, you know, mature themed content if it's going to take on Netflix or HBO Max in the US. But so far from the launch titles, I don't know, I'm a little bit underwhelmed, I've got to say. I mean, when you look at the TV series, it's mainly from, you know, the last decade or even the one before, Grey's Anatomy, Lost, The X-Files, you know, it's a bit retro. I think, you know, they're going to have to start investing in original content if they really want to take on the likes of Netflix.
Yes, definitely. I think what I probably should say, just for a bit of context, if anyone has completely missed this news, Star is Disney bringing in, yes, content aimed at an adult audience to the Disney Plus platform. So like you've just said, Pia, there's a lot of stuff from Fox, which of course Disney acquired last year. So yeah, X-Files, I don't know if Lost was Fox, I think it was ABC, but you know, you get stuff like that on there. Sure, there's I completely get what you mean. I do think that so much of what is on there at the moment is just legacy stuff, And it's going to take them a while to build up a decent platform, because I think at the moment they've only got 4 original star titles, if I remember right.
Yeah, and much like with Netflix, they're a bit cagey about the use of original, because sometimes these are shows that have already been shown on other networks and now Disney Plus is picking them up. But yeah, I mean, I'm sure that they will invest in this content, much as they have done with Marvel and Star Wars, you know, which seem to be each having 10 new shows over the next 2 years. I have no doubt that that section will grow as well. So I don't know, it's one to watch, definitely. And by that, I mean one to see, to see how things develop, because you've probably already watched it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'm curious to see if this is finally what Disney needs to get that Lizzie McGuire reboot off the ground. Because, of course, that rumor has it that that got cancelled because it was too adult for Disney Plus.
Really?
But surely it'd be fine for Star.
Yeah, well, let's hope so, Tom. Eh?
Yeah, absolutely. I want to see... I want to see that episode where Lizzie and Gordo hijack a bus to drive it across the border. But, you know, we'll see how that goes.
And full disclosure, Tom, all your enthusiasm has to come from that nice care package Disney sent you with the balloons and the chocolate. And what else was there in there?
Listen, I don't know what you mean. Peter, I'm not sponsored by Disney Plus in any regard. How dare you? Oh, my notebook. Lovely. Yes, they did send me a lovely care package, which I'll admit the chocolate is very nice and the contents of which are very nice. But hey, I will not be swayed, even though they do have my favorite program on there, Lost, which I know you don't like. Oh. And
well, Tom, have you watched it to the end, right? Because you said you were watching it through with your fiance. Have you seen
the ending? I've watched it through to the end twice. So this is now third viewing. Okay. Yeah.
But again, for context, viewers, Tom liked the end of Game of Thrones. So I'll just leave it there.
Oh, throw me under the bus. Speaking of things getting thrown under the bus, Facebook's plans for world domination, kind of. I know. No. So the loser for this week is Facebook's U-turn with regards to its ongoing battle with the Australian government. Now, if you missed the news last week, the big hubbub was caused from the fact that Facebook pulled all its news content from its platform in Australia. So when Australians woke up, their news feeds were almost completely barren, with the exception of, I don't know, their friends' baby pictures and, I don't know, an aunt complaining about neighbors. You know, whatever was on there, it probably wasn't, you know, that engaging. But now that has seen a U-turn after it seems as though Mark Zuckerberg has had discussions with representatives of the Australian government to, I guess, water down the bill that was going on there, which you could probably explain in better detail than I, Peter.
It seems that that's what happened. In the best traditions of democracy, a deal has been reached in the shadowy corridors where no one can see. And so some changes are going to occur to the proposed law, because the law was just a proposal. It wasn't even in effect when Facebook decided to take down all news content. And so, yeah, we're just going to have to wait and see what the new legislation looks like. But yeah, surely it's going to be watered down. And in fact, it seems that there are not many good guys in the story here, because, you know, Rupert Murdoch's media organization is quite heavily involved in lobbying for charges that Facebook has to pay on news content. So it's hard to see, you know, whether there are good intentions at play here as well.
Yeah, I think it depends on how much the smaller news outlets and like the local papers benefit from something like that, because that was part of the intention. And I do think that for some people, that was exactly why they were proposing this rule in the first place. But again, it then obviously benefits the larger conglomerates. So yeah, it's a bit of a two-sided coin, but it has set an interesting precedent that, I mean, you know, there's of course a slight bias here. You and I both working for a news site that, you know, do we like the idea of Facebook, you know, paying news sites extra for the content that is featured? Of course, but I also recognize that the logistics of something like that, given how much content is shared on social media, just sounds like an absolute nightmare.
Yeah, I mean, I would hope that it would come with some kind of accreditation because, of course, there's been so many scandals recently with Facebook, Cambridge Analytica stuff, of them promoting, you know, fake news. So if these charges come along with some kind of, yeah, as I say, accreditation or recognition of, you know, reliable sources, I think that would be a good thing.
That's a great point, to be fair. Yeah, can only hope that better things are down the road. And yeah, we'll have to see. It's a developing story, so stay tuned to Recombu for, I guess, the latest updates as and when they come in. And with the week's winners and losers out of the way, we get to come to, well, my favorite bit of the show, the show and tell segment, where we get to look at some shiny things. So, Peter, I know you have two brand new phones with you at the moment, the Moto G10 and the Moto G30, am I correct?
So I'm reviewing the Motorola G10, and that costs £129.99. And I'm also reviewing the Motorola G30, which is priced at £159.99.
Tell me a bit more about them, because Moto range, famous for offering high specs at a low price. Is it the same sort of just here? Are there new specs being brought down to the same price level? Run us through it.
Sure. So Motorola have a pretty good reputation for making reliable budget phones. In this case, we've got the lower end of the spectrum is the G10. That's got a 5,000 mAh battery. It's got a Snapdragon 460 processor. You know, pretty impressive phone from what I've seen of it so far, in that it fulfills all those sort of needs you're going to have at that budget. Then the Motorola G30, slightly more expensive at £159.99. That's got a Snapdragon 662 processor, and it's got a 64 megapixel main sensor on the camera. But most impressively for me, it's got a 90 hertz screen refresh rate.
Nice. That's really cool. Yeah, I mean, 90 hertz at that price, it just seems like a bit of a bargain to me.
Yeah, exactly. You really don't see it very often at that end of the budget spectrum. So it's exciting to see that kind of feature trickle down now to the budget buyers.
And are you leaning more towards one or the other at the moment, or do you still need to do a bit more testing?
I think I need to do a bit more testing, especially of the cameras, to see which one really justifies the price. You know, if there's an extra £30 in it, I wouldn't be against spending an extra £30 for a better camera. But yeah, so far, they're impressive little phones. Like you say, nice to have that 90 hertz display at that price.
Fair enough. I'm looking forward to seeing your review, Peter.
Thanks, Tom.
I know. I love paying you compliments. Seeing that smile. So I guess on from smartphones to smartwatches, because that seems to be my gig around here, unofficial smart watch person. I don't know. I'm convinced there's some alcohol in this beer, because I tell you what, the more I drink, the sleepier I'm becoming.
You're such a lightweight, Tom, though. No one would be surprised if you got drunk on non-alcoholic beer.
I know. It's really bad. I remember once we went out for what was the occasion? I think it was just, yeah, it was like a boozy journalist lunch, and I had half a pint, and I came back and
fell asleep. Hang on a minute, Tom. I'm scared that this isn't going to make the final edit if you carry on with this story. Half a pint. What happened next?
Yeah, it's going to cut here and pick up. And then I carried him out in the wheelbarrow. So for this week, I'm testing out this bad boy here. If I can try and get the screen up for a sec. It is the Honor Watch ES, which admittedly, it's not brand new. I've had this on my review pile now for about a month or two, but due to just other products coming in, I finally got around to getting to it now. And I have to say, so far, I'm quite impressed. I'm only a few days into using it, but it does remind me of the Honor Band 5, which is a fitness tracker I tested out some years ago, and was really impressed with that because it had tons of features in it. It had, you know, pedometer, blood oxygen tracking, sleep tracking, workouts, all sorts of stuff, but it was only £30, and it was just, it kind of blew everything out of the water. The price for the Watch ES I don't remember off the top of my head, but I'm 99% sure that it's just under £100. Hopefully I'm getting that right. But again, it's another fitness tracker aimed at the more affordable end of the market, going against specifically probably the Fitbit Charge series. And yeah, I'm enjoying it so far. It's got a really nice screen. Still uses the same type of sleep tracking that was available on the Honor Band 5, which gives you tangible advice on how to improve your quality of sleep, which I really like. It's just something that happens quite a lot with fitness trackers is that they'll give you tons of information, but not boil that down in a way that actually makes sense. This is not the case with the Honor Watch. And yeah, I'm enjoying it so far. Hopefully we'll have a couple of words on it soon.
Cool. So you're taking it for a couple of runs?
Not for any runs yet. I have taken it on a couple of lifts of the old kettlebell, which I guess is probably not quite the same, not on, exactly the use case.
Stuff those guns for the camera. Show them off. Do your stuff.
No, I'll save that. I'll save that for when we're in the office. And then I'll make it the thumbnail of the video. How about that?
Mm, that's good. You'll get me clicking. So, yeah. No, it sounds good. Has it got more features than the Honor Band 5? Has this got GPS maybe or 24/7 heart rate tracking?
So it doesn't have untethered GPS, as far as I'm aware. It still needs to connect to a phone, which, yeah, a little bit problematic if you don't want to bring your phone with you on a run.
That's a big problem, really. I mean, I always take my phone with me when I'm running.
Yeah, I think it depends. I find it to be a bit of a distraction, if I'm honest. So I much prefer just having everything that I need there on a smartwatch, which is why I always go back to my Garmin Venue, because that has GPS, Spotify, you know, workout tracking. It's just that has everything I would want. So with something like this, it's, you know, it's nice that it's cheap and it's functional. But yeah, there is that trade-off in that you're not getting all of those great features that you would on a more expensive device. In terms of what's new, I haven't dived that much into it yet. For the most part, the biggest difference is just having a larger screen, one that's really bright and just easy to look at. It's very responsive. So yeah, that's more or less it. I'm sure I probably missed some huge difference, and the PR for Honor is watching this video just yelling at the screen. But you know, I will get around to that and give the watch its its day in court in a proper review.
Nice, yeah, sounds good. The screen does look attractive.
So we'll move on swiftly to your comments. Now, we've had a couple of different comments coming from you wonderful viewers of Recombu content. And as always, we're going to run through them now. So let's see. First comment coming in from the wonderfully named Greg. Galaxy Buds were voted most likely to fall into the toilet. Now, Greg, I got two questions there. Who voted? And were you on the panel?
Yeah, to answer your first question, I think that was one of the down ballot races in the US presidential election. But yeah, I hope that's not based on his personal experience. That's all I can say.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know about you, Peter, but you know, touch wood, I've never dropped earbuds into the toilet. But I was reading that.
I've never touched wood while I've been in the toilet either. But each their own song.
Oh, Peter, you're filthy, but I love it. But honestly, depending on the price of the earbuds, if they went into the toilet, I don't think I'd be fishing them out.
Yeah, I've got to say, I don't think I would be. And if he was caught in the middle of a bout of pebble dashing, perhaps he didn't even notice.
Oh, no. Peter. It's okay. I love having you here. I really do. Sorry, something on a little bit more.
Well, I've been invited back again.
No. Well. It's okay though. We got a nicer comment here, which I think is directed at you. So,
Why is there the surprise in your voice there, Tom?
It's nice. I know. It's okay. I'm sorry, Pia. I'm sorry. So, Lego Peace commented, Tech Dudes reviewing Lego, best video ever. And I'm assuming that this is in relation to your recent unboxing and hands-on of the Lego video.
I am indeed a tech dude, so I don't know who else they could be referring to. But yeah, I've had some fun with this Lego video kit to make your own augmented reality music videos with little Lego minifigures. And yeah, you know, it's a nice bit of fun. It sort of joins tech with Lego for a bit of a distraction. I'm not sure if it's got staying power or not. It's hard to predict with these things, but you know, it was a fun little afternoon getting to work and getting him to dance around the flat.
Yeah, just drop it in the toilet.
That's the takeaway. If there's one takeaway point from this week's episode, it's don't drop your tech in the toilet.
Oh, I'm definitely making that the headline. Let's see. So the comment to round out this week's episode from Baxter Munga, I hope I'm saying that correctly. They have said, it's been a minute, finally more content. Well, Baxter, thank you for tuning in. And yes, we're back in full swing. Recombu is back. We're putting out weekly content. We've got unboxings, hands-ons, versus videos, whatever else. I'm sure Peter will jump in and, you know, do a little dance with his Lego video stuff.
Whenever you want, Tom. Whenever you want.
And, of course, we have this show right here, RecomBEERS, which airs once a week, every Friday. So we hope you enjoyed this episode, and we hope you will tune into next week's episode and next week's and next week's and next week's until the end of time. But I want to say thank you very much to our special guest, Pia Phelps, for joining us. Pia, it's been really nice having you.
Thanks very much, Tom. It's been my pleasure to be here.
That's what you just say. It's been the worst day of my life being here. And to you, the audience at home, if you haven't hit the subscribe button, please do so now. It will make our day if you do. And thanks for tuning in. Hope to see you in the next one.